King Henry is holding a council of state in his London palace. The Duke of Buckingham and one or two other lords have been arrested on a charge of conspiracy against his majesty and are now imprisoned in the Tower. The king speaks.
My life itself and the best heart of it thanks you, Lord Cardinal. I stood at the level of a full-charged confederacy and give thanks to you that choked it.
Your majesty.
Let me call before us that gentleman of Buckingham's. In person, I'll hear him his confessions justify. And point by point, the treasons of his master he shall again relate.
Room for the Queen! Room for the Queen!
Rise, madam.
Nay, we must longer kneel. I am a suitor.
Arise and take place by us. Half your suit, never named to us. You have half our power. The other moiety, ere you ask, is given. Repeat your will and take it.
Thank your majesty.
Lady mine, proceed.
I am solicited, not by a few and those of true condition, that your subjects are in great grievance. There have been commissions sent down among them which have floored the heart of all their loyalties, wherein, although my good Lord Cardinal, they vent reproaches most bitterly on you as putter on of these exactions, yet the king, our master, whose honor heaven shield from soil, even he escapes not language unmannerly, yea, such which breaks the sides of loyalty, and almost appears in loud rebellion.
Not almost appears, it doth appear. But upon these taxations, the weavers, spinsters, carders, fullers, who, unfit for other life, compelled by hunger and lack of other means, in desperate manner, daring the event to the teeth, are all in uproar.
Taxation? Wherein, and what taxation? My Lord Cardinal, you that are blamed for it alike with us, know you of this taxation?
Please you, sir, I know but of a single part in aught pertains to the state, and front but in that file where others tell steps with me.
No, my lord, you know no more than others, but you frame things that are known alike, which are not wholesome to those that would not know them, and yet must perforce be their acquaintance.
Still the exaction? The nature of it? In what kind, let's know, is this exaction?
The subject's grief comes through commissions, which compel from each the sixth part of his substance to be levied without delay. And the pretense for this is named your wars in France. I would your highness would give it quick consideration, for there is no primer business.
By my life, this is against our pleasure.
And for me, I have no further gone in this than by a single voice, and that not past me, but by learned approbation of it. If I am traduced by ignorant tongues, which neither know my faculties nor person, yet will be the chronicles of my doing, let me say it is but a fate of plague that virtue must go through.
Things done well and with a care exempt themselves from fear. Have you a precedent of this commission? I believe not any. To every county where this is questioned, send out letters, with free pardon to each man that has denied the force of this commission. Trail up to it. I put it to your care.
Good secretary, a word with you. Let there be letters writ to every shire of the king's grace and pardon. Let it be noised that through our intercession this revokement and pardon comes. I shall anon advise you further in the proceeding.
I am sorry that the Duke of Buckingham is run in your displeasure.
It grieves many. The gentleman is learned and a most rare speaker, to nature none more bound. Sit by us.
Your Majesty.
Ah, you shall hear this was his gentleman in trust. Bid him recount the four recited practices, whereof we cannot feel too little, hear too much.
Stand forth. And with bold spirit, relate what you, most like a careful subject, have collected out of the Duke of Buckingham.
First, it was usual with him every day it would infect his speech, that if the king should without issue die, he'll carry it so to make the scepter his.
Please, Your Highness, note this dangerous conception in this point. Not friended by his wish, to your high person, his will is most malignant.
My learned Lord Cardinal, deliver all with charity.
Speak on. How grounded he his title to the crown upon our fail?
Not long before Your Highness sped to France, the Duke did of me demand, what was the speech among the Londoners concerning the French journey? I replied, men feared the French would prove perfidious to the king's danger. Presently the Duke said 'twas the fear indeed, and that he doubted 'twould prove the verity of certain words spoke by a holy monk. Neither the king nor his heirs shall prosper. The Duke shall govern England.
If I know you well, you were the Duke Surveyor and lost your office on the complaint of the tenants. Take good heed you charge not in your spleen a noble person and spoil your nobler soul.
Let him on. Go forward.
On my soul, I'll speak the truth. I told my lord the Duke, by the devil's illusions, the monk might be deceived. He answered, tush, it can do me no damage, adding further, that had the king in his last sickness failed, the cardinal's and Sir Thomas Lovell's heads should have gone off.
Huh? What, Sir Rank? Ah, there's a mischief in this man. Proceed.
Being at Greenwich, after Your Highness had reproved the Duke about Sir William Bulmer.
I remember of such a time. What hence?
If, quoth he, I for this had been committed, as to the tower, I thought, I would have played the part my father meant to act upon the usurper Richard, who, being at Salisbury, made suit to Cummings' presence, which, if granted, as he made semblance of his duty, would have put his knife into him.
A triumph traitor bears his period to sheathe his knife in us. He is attached. Call him to present trial. If he may find mercy in the law, 'tis his. If none, let him not seek to thus. By day and night, he's traitor to the height.
Preparations are made for the Duke of Buckingham to be brought to trial. Meanwhile, Cardinal Wolsey gives a great supper at York Place to many fair guests and noble gentlemen, among them Anne Bullen.
You are welcome, my fair guest.
My lord.
That noble lady or gentleman that is not freely merry is not my friend. This to confirm my welcome, and to you all, good health.
My lord.
What's that? All that voice and to what end? Hey, ladies, fear not. By all the laws of war, you're privileged.
My lord cardinal.
How now? What is it?
A noble troop of strangers. For so they seem. They've left their barge and landed, and hither make as great ambassadors from foreign princes.
Oh. Say, Lord Chamberlain, they have done my poor house grace, for which I pay them 1,000 thanks, and pray them take their pleasure.
Fairest hand I ever touched. Oh, beauty, till now I never knew thee.
My Lord Chamberlain, prithee come hither.
What fair lady is that?
And please your grace, Sir Thomas Bullen's daughter.
By heaven, she's a dainty one. Sweetheart, I were unmannerly to take you out and not to kiss you.
A health, gentlemen, let it go round.
Sir Thomas Lovell. Is the banquet ready in the privy chamber?
Yes, my lord.
Your grace, I fear, with dancing is a little heated.
I fear too much.
There's fresher air, my lord, in the next chamber.
Lead in your ladies, everyone. Ah, sweet partner, I must not yet forsake you. Let's be merry, and then let's dream who's best in favor. Let the music knock it.
The trial of the Duke of Buckingham has resulted in his condemnation. In a street of London, on his way to execution, he speaks to some of those who are standing by.
All good people, you that thus far have come to pity me, hear what I say, and then go home and lose me. I have this day received a traitor's judgment, and by that name must die. Yet heaven bear witness, and if I have a conscience, let it sink me, even as the axe falls, if I be not faithful. The law, I bear no malice for my death, has done upon the premises but justice. But those that sought it, I could wish more Christians. Be what they will, I heartily forgive them. Yet let them look they glory not in mischief, nor build their evils on the graves of great men, for then my guiltless blood must cry against them. For further life in this world I ne'er hope, nor will I sue, although the king have mercies more than I dare make faults. You few that loved me, and dare be bold to weep for Buckingham, go with me like good angels to my end. And as the long divorce of Steele falls on me, make of your prayers one sweet sacrifice and lift my soul to heaven. Lead on, O God's name.
Now, after 20 years of marriage, the king's mind is bent on a separation between himself and Catherine. Apparently, there are two reasons for this: his meeting with Anne Bullen, and the fact that Catherine was the widow of his elder brother. Wolsey supports his action, and in association with Cardinal Campius, is commissioned by Rome to bring the case to judgment. The court is assembled in the Hall of Blackfriars.
Whilst our commission from Rome is read, let silence be commanded.
What's the need? It hath already publicly been read.
Be it so. Proceed.
Say, Henry, King of England, come into the court.
Henry, King of England, come into the court.
Here.
Say, Catherine, Queen of England, come into the court.
Catherine, Queen of England, come into the court.
Sir, I desire you do me right and justice, and to bestow your pity on me. For I am a most poor woman, and a stranger born out of your dominions, having here no judge indifferent, nor no more assurance of equal friendship and proceeding. Alas, sir, in what have I offended you? What cause hath my behavior given to your displeasure, that thus you should proceed to put me off and take your good grace from me? Heaven witness, I have been to you a true and humble wife, at all times to your will conformable, ever in fear to kindle your dislike, yea, subject to your countenance, glad or sorry, as I saw it inclined. When was the hour I ever contradicted your desire, or made it not mine too? Oh, which of your friends have I not strove to love, although I knew he were mine enemy? What friend of mine that had to him derived your anger did I continue in my liking? Nay, gave notice he was from thence discharged. Sir, call to mind that I have been your wife in disobedience upward of 20 years, and have been blessed with many children by you. If in the course and process of this time you can report, and prove it too, against mine honor aught, my bond to wedlock, or my love and duty against your sacred person. In God's name, turn me away, and let the false contempt shut door upon me, and so give me up to the sharpest kind of justice. Please you, sir, the king, your father, was reputed for a prince most prudent, of an excellent and unmatched wit and judgment. Ferdinand, my father, king of Spain, was reckoned one the wisest prince that there had reigned by many a year before. It is not to be questioned that they had gathered a wise council to them of every realm that did debate this business, who deemed our marriage lawful. Wherefore I humbly beseech you, sir, to spare me, till I may be by my friends in Spain advised, whose counsel I will implore. If not, in the name of God, your pleasure be fulfilled.
You have here, lady, and of your choice, these reverend fathers, men of singular integrity and learning, to plead your cause.
Lord Cardinal, to you I speak.
Your pleasure, madam.
Sir, I am about to weep, but thinking that we are a queen, or long have dreamed so, certain the daughter of a king, my drops of tears I'll turn to sparks of fire.
Be patient, yes.
I will, when you are humble, nay, before, or God will punish me. I do believe, induced by potent circumstance, that you are mine enemy. And make my challenge, you shall not be my judge, for it is you have blown this coal betwixt my lord and me, which God's due quench. Therefore I say again, I utterly abhor, yea, from my soul, refuse you for my judge, whom yet once more I hold my most malicious foe, and think not at all a friend to truth.
I do profess you speak not like yourself, whoever yet have stood for charity, and displayed the effects of disposition gentle, and of wisdom o'ertopping woman's power. Madam, you do me wrong. I have no spleen against you. You charge me that I have blown this coal. I do deny it. The king is present. Therefore in him it lies to cure me. And the cure is to remove these thoughts from you. I do beseech you, gracious madam, to unthink your speaking and to say so no more.
My lord, I am a simple woman, much too weak to oppose your cunning. Your meek and humble mouth, you sign your place and calling in full seeming with meekness and humility, but your heart is crammed with arrogance, spleen, and pride. I must tell you, you tender more your person's honor than your high profession spiritual, that again I do refuse you for my judge. And here, before you all, appeal unto the Pope to bring my whole cause for his holiness and to be judged by him.
The queen is obstinate, stubborn to justice, apt to accuse it, and disdainful to be tried by it. It is not well. She's going away.
Call her again.
Catherine, Queen of England, come into the court.
Madam, your call back.
Of what need you note it? Pray you keep your way. When you are called, return. Now, the Lord help me, they vex me past my patience. Pray you pass on. I will not tarry, no, nor ever more upon this business my appearance make in any of their courts.
Go thy ways, Kate. That man in the world who shall report he has a better wife, let him in not be trusted for speaking false in that. Thou art alone, if thy rare qualities, sweet gentleness, thy meekness, saint-like, wife-like government, obeying and commanding, and thy part sovereign and pious else, could speak thee out, the queen of earthly queens. She's noble born, and like her true nobility, she has carried herself towards thee.
In the queen's apartments in the royal palace, her majesty and her women are at work.
Take thy lute, wench. My soul grows sad with troubles. Sing and disperse them if thou canst. leave working.
Your Grace.
How now?
And please, Your Grace, the two great cardinals wait in the presence.
Pray their graces to come near.
Madam.
What can be their business with me? A poor, weak woman fallen from favor. I do not like their coming. Now I think on, they should be good men, their affairs as righteous. But all hoods make not monks.
Peace to your highness. Peace to your highness.
Your graces find me here part of a housewife. What are your pleasures with me, reverend lord?
May it please you, noble madam, to withdraw into your private chamber. We shall give you the full cause of our coming.
Speak it here. There is nothing I have done yet to my conscience deserves a corner. Would all other women could speak this with as free a soul as I do. My lords, I care not. So much am I happy above a number. If my actions were tried by every tongue, every eye saw them, envy and base opinion set against them, I know my life so even. If your business seek me out, and that way I am wife in, out with it boldly. Truth loves open dealing.
Noble lady, I am sorry my integrity should breed so deep suspicion where all faith was meant. We come not by the way of accusation to taint that honor every good tongue blesses, nor to betray you any way to sorrow. You have too much, good lady. But to know how you stand minded in the weighty difference between the king and you, and to deliver, like free and honest men, our just opinions and comforts to your cause.
Most honest. My lord of York, out of his noble nature, forgetting, like a good man, your late censure, both of his truth and kin, which was too far, offers, as I do, in a sign of peace, his service and his counsel.
To betray me. My lords, I thank you both for your good wills. Ye speak like honest men. Pray God ye prove so. But how to make you suddenly an answer in such a point of weight, so near mine honor, more near my life, I fear, with my weak wit unto such men of gravity and learning. In truth, I know not. Good your graces, let me have time and counsel for my cause. Alas, I am a woman, friendless, hopeless.
Madam, you wrong the king's love with these fears. Your hopes and friends are infinite.
In England, but little for my profit. Can you think, lords, that any Englishman dare give me counsel, or be a known friend against his highness' pleasure? They are, as all my other comforts, far hence in mine own country, lords.
I would your grace would leave your griefs and take my counsel.
How, sir?
Put your main cause into the king's protection. He's loving and most gracious. It will be much, both for your honor better and your cause. For if the trial of the law protects you, you'll part away disgraced.
He tells you rightly.
Ye tell me what ye wish for both. My ruin. Is this your Christian counsel? Out upon ye. Heaven is above all yet. There sits a judge no king can corrupt.
Your rage if mistakes are...
The more shame for ye. Holy men, I thought ye. Upon my soul, two reverend cardinal virtues. But cardinal sins and hollow hearts, I fear ye. Mend them for shame, my lords. Is this your comfort? I will not wish ye half my miseries. I have more charity. But say, I warn thee, take heed, for heaven's sake, take heed, lest at once the burden of my sorrows fall upon thee.
Madam, this is mere distraction. You turn the good we offer into envy.
Ye turn me into nothing. Woe upon you and all such false professors. Would you have me, if you have any justice, any pity, if you be anything but churchmen's habits, put my sick cause into his hands that hates me? Alas, banish me his bed already, his love too long ago. I am old, my lords, and all the fellowship I now hold with him is only my obedience. What can happen to me above this wretchedness? All your studies make me a curse like this.
Your fears are worse.
Have I lived thus long? Let me speak myself, since virtue finds no friends. A wife, a true one, a woman, I dare say, without vainglory, never yet branded with suspicion. Have I, with all my full affection, still met the king, loved him next heaven, obeyed him, been out of fondness, superstitious to him, almost forgot my prayers to content him? And am I thus rewarded? 'Tis not well, lords. Bring me a constant woman to her husband, one that ne'er dreamed a joy beyond his pleasure, and to that woman, when she has done most, yet will I add an honor, a great patience.
Madam, you wander from the good we aim at.
My lord, I dare not make myself so guilty to give up willingly that noble title your master wed me to. Nothing but death shall e'er divorce my dignities.
Pray hear me.
Would I had never trod this English earth, or felt the flatteries that grow upon it. You have angels' faces, but heaven knows your hearts. What will become of me now, wretched lady? Shipwrecked upon a kingdom where no pity, no friends, no hope. No kindred weep for me, almost no grave allowed me. Like the lily that once was mistress of the field and flourished, I'll hang my head and perish.
If your grace could but be brought to know our ends are honest, you'd feel more comfort. Why should we, good lady, upon what cause wrong you? Alas, our places, the way of our profession is against it. We are to cure such sorrows, not to sow them.
Madam, you'll find it so. You wrong your virtues, these weak women's fears. The king loves you. Beware you lose it not. For us, if you please to trust us in your business, we are ready to use our utmost studies in your service.
Do what ye will, my lords. And pray forgive me if I have used myself unmannerly. You know I am a woman lacking wit to make a seemly answer to such persons. Pray do my service to his majesty. He has my heart yet, and shall have my prayers while I shall have my life. Come, reverend fathers, bestow your counsels on me. She now begs, but little thought when she set footing here, she should have bought her dignity so dear.
The cardinal's enemies are seizing their opportunity. Letters which he sent to the Pope have miscarried and come into the king's possession. His majesty has also received a list of the immense possessions that Wolsey has gathered together.
The king!
What piles of wealth have he accumulated to his own portion? And what expense money are seems to owe for him? Have we been able to rip that he reduced to Vienna?
Now, my lord, saw you the cardinal?
My lord, we have stood here observing him. See, some strange commotion is in his brain. He bites his lip and starts. Stops on a sudden, looks upon the ground, then lays his finger on his temple. Straight springs out into the fast gate, then stops again, strikes his breast hard, and anon he casts his eye against the moon. In most strange postures we have seen him set himself.
It may well be. This morning, papers of state he set me to peruse as I required, and what you what I found there, on my conscience, put unwittingly, forsooth, an inventory, thus importing the several parcels of his plate, his treasure, rich stuffs and ornaments of household, which I find at such proud rate that it outspeaks possession of a subject.
It's heaven's will. Some spirit put this paper in the packet to bless your eye withal.
If we did think his contemplation were above the earth, but fixed on spiritual object, he should still dwell on his music. But I am afraid his thinkings are below the moon, not worth his serious considering.
Heaven forgive me. Ever God bless your highness.
Good my lord, you are full of heavenly stuff, and bear the inventory of your best graces in your mind, the which you are now running o'er. You have scarce time to steal from spiritual leisure a brief span to keep your earthly order. Sure in that, I deem you an ill husband, and I'm glad to have you therein my companion.
Sir, for holy offices I have a time. A time to think upon the part of business which I bear in the state. And nature does require her times of preservation, which perforce I, her frail son, among my brethren mortal, must give my attendance to.
You have said well.
And ever may your highness yoke together, as I will lend you cause, my doing well with my well saying.
'Tis well said again, and 'tis a kind of good deed to say well. And yet, words are no deed.
Yes.
My father loved you. He said he did. And with his deed did crown his word upon you. Since I had my office, I have kept you next my heart. I have not alone employed you where high profits might come home, but paired my present habits to bestow my bounties on you.
What do this mean? Lord, increase this business.
Have I not made you the prime man of the state? I pray you tell me if what I now pronounce you have found true. And if you may confess it, say withal if you are bound to us or no. What say you?
My sovereign, I confess your royal graces showered on me daily have been more than could my studied purposes requite, which went beyond all man's endeavors. My endeavors have ever come too short of my desires, yet filed with my abilities. Mine own ends have been mine, so that evermore they pointed to the good of your most sacred person and the profit of the state. For your great graces heaped upon me, poor undeserver, I can nothing render but allegiant thanks, my prayers to heaven for you, my loyalty, which ever has and ever shall be growing, till death that winter kill.
Early answered. A loyal and obedient subject is therein illustrated. The honor of it does pay the act of it. As in the contrary, the foulness is the punishment. I presume that as my hand hath opened bounty to you, my heart dropped love, my power rained honor, more on you than any, so
your hand and heart,
your brain and every function of your power should, notwithstanding that your bond of duty, as 'twere in love's particular, be more to me, your friend, than any?
I do profess that for your highness' good I ever labored more than for mine own. But I am, have, and will be. Though all the world should crack their duty to you and throw it from their soul, though perils did abound as thick as thought could make them and appear in forms more horrid, yet my duty, as doth a rock against the chiding flood, should the approach of this wild river break and stand unshaken yours.
'Tis nobly spoken. Take notice, lords, he has a loyal breast, for you have seen him opened. Read o'er this, and after this, and then to breakfast with what appetite you have. Come, lord.
What should this mean? What sudden anger is this? Ah, it is so. This paper has undone me. It is the account of all that world of wealth I have drawn together for mine own ends. Indeed, to gain the popedom and feed my friends in Rome. Oh, negligence fit for a fool to fall by. What cross devil made me to put this main secret in the packet I sent the king? Is there no way to cure this? No new device to beat this from his brains, I know it will stir him strongly. Yet I know a way. If it take right, in spite of fortune, will bring me off again.
Ah, what's this? To the Pope.
The letter, as I live, with all the business I writ to His Holiness. Nay, then, farewell. I have touched the highest point of all my greatness. And from that full meridian of my glory, I haste now to my setting. I shall fall like a bright exhalation in the evening, and no man see me more. So farewell, a long farewell to all my greatness. This is the state of man. Today he puts forth the tender leaves of hopes. Tomorrow blossoms and bears his blushing honors thick upon him. The third day comes a frost, a killing frost. And when he thinks, good easy man, full surely his greatness is a-ripening, nips his root, and then he falls, as I do. I have ventured like little wanton boys that swim on bladders this many summers in a sea of glory, but far beyond my depth. My high-blown pride at length broke under me, and now has left me, weary and old with service, to the mercy of a rude stream that must forever hide me. Vain pomp and glory of this world, I hate it. Feel my heart new open. Oh, how wretched is that poor man that hangs on princes' favors. There is betwixt that smile we would aspire to, that sweet aspect of princes, and their ruin, more pangs and fears than wars or women have. And when he falls like Lucifer, never to hope again.
Your Grace.
Why, how now, Cromwell?
How does your Grace?
Why, well. What news abroad?
The heaviest and the worst is your displeasure with the king.
God bless him.
The next is that Sir Thomas More is chosen Lord Chancellor in your place.
That's somewhat sudden. What more?
That Cranmer is returned with welcome, installed Lord Archbishop of Canterbury.
That's news indeed.
Last, that the Lady Anne, whom the king hath in secrecy long married, this day was viewed in open as his queen going to chapel. And the voice is now only about her coronation.
There was the weight that pulled me down. Cromwell, I did not think to shed a tear in all my miseries. But thou hast forced me out of thy honest truth to play the woman. Let's dry our eyes. And thus far hear me, Cromwell. And when I am forgotten, as I shall be, and sleep in dull, cold marble, where no mention of me more must be heard of. Say, I taught thee. Say, Wolsey, that once trod the ways of glory, and sounded all the depths and shoals of honor, found thee a way out of his wreck to rise in. A sure and safe one, though their master missed it. Mark but my fall, and that that ruined me. Cromwell, I charge thee, fling away ambition. By that sin fell the angels. How can man, then, the image of his maker, hope to win by it? Love thyself last. Cherish those hearts that hate thee. Corruption wins not more than honesty. Still in thy right hand, carry gentle peace to silence envious tongues. Be just and fear not. Let all the ends thou aim'st at be thy country's, thy God's, and truth's. Then, if thou fall'st, O Cromwell, thou fall'st a blessed martyr. Serve the king and... Pretty lead me in. There take an inventory of all I have to the last penny. 'Tis the king's. My robe and my integrity to heaven is all I dare now call mine own. Oh, Cromwell, Cromwell, had I but served my God with half the zeal I served my king, he would not in mine age have left be naked to mine enemies.
Good sir, have patience.
So I have. Farewell the hopes of court, my hopes in heaven.
Queen Catherine, persisting in her refusal to have her case tried by any court of law, has left London and in the end is divorced in her absence. Now she is at Kimbolton.
How does your grace?
Oh, Griffith, sick to death. My legs, like loaden branches, bow to the earth, willing to leave their burden. Reach a chair. So. Now methinks I feel a little ease. Didst thou not tell me, Griffith, as thou ledst me, that the great child of honor, Cardinal Wolsey, was dead?
Yes, madam, but I think your grace, out of the pain you suffer, gave no ear to it.
Prithee, good Griffith, tell me how he died. If well, he stepped before me happily for my example.
Well, the voice goes, madam, after the stout Earl Northumberland arrested him at York and brought him forward as a man sorely tainted to his answer, he fell sick suddenly and grew so ill he could not sit his mule.
Alas, poor man.
At last, with easy roads, he came to Leicester, lodged in the abbey, where the reverend abbot, with all his convent, honorably received him, to whom he gave these words. O Father Abbot, an old man, broken with the storms of state, is come to lay his weary bones among you. Give him a little earth for charity. So went to bed, where eagerly his sickness pursued him still, and three nights after this, about the hour of eight, which he himself foretold should be his last, full of repentance, continual meditations, tears and sorrows, he gave his honors to the world again, his blessed path to heaven, and slept in peace.
So may he rest. His faults lie gently on him. Yet thus far, Griffith, give me leave to speak him, and yet with charity. He was a man of an unbounded stomach, ever ranking himself with princes, one that by suggestion tied all the kingdom. Simony was fair play. His own opinion was his law. In the presence he would say untruths and be ever double both in his words and meaning. He was never but where he meant to ruin, pitiful. His promises were, as he then was, mighty, but his performance, as he is now, nothing. Of his own body, he was ill, and gave the clergy ill example.
Noble madam, men's evil manners live in brass. Their virtues we write in water. May it please your highness to hear me speak his good now.
Yes, good Griffith, I wear malicious else.
This cardinal, though from a humble stock, undoubtedly was fashioned to much honor from his cradle. He was a scholar and a ripe and good one, exceeding wise, fair-spoken and persuading, lofty and sour to them that loved him not, but to those men that sought him sweet as summer. Though he were unsatisfied in getting, which was a sin, yet in bestowing, madam, he was most princely. So excellent in art, and still so rising, that Christendom shall ever speak his virtue. His overthrow heaped happiness upon him, for then, and not till then, he felt himself, and found the blessedness of being little. And to add greater honors to his age than man could give him, he died fearing God.
After my death, I wish no other herald, no other speaker of my living actions to keep mine honor from corruption, but such an honest chronicler as Griffith.
Oh.
Patience, be near me still, and set me lower. I have not long to trouble thee. Good Griffith, cause the musicians play me that sad note I named my knell, whilst I sit meditating on that celestial harmony I go to.
Good wench, let's sit down quiet, for fear we wake up.
Spirit of peace, where are ye? Are ye all gone and leave me here in wretchedness behind ye?
Madam, we are here.
It is not you I call for. Saw ye none enter since I slept?
None, madam.
No. Saw ye not even now a blessed troop invite me to a banquet, whose bright faces cast thousand beams upon me like the sun? They promised me eternal happiness and brought me garlands with them, which I feel I am not worthy yet to wear. I shall, assuredly.
I am most joyful, madam, such good dreams possess your fancy.
Bid the music leave. They're harsh and heavy to me.
Do you note how much her grace is altered on the sudden? How long her face is drawn? How pale she looks and of an earthy cold? Mark her eyes.
She is going. Wench, pray, pray.
Heaven comfort her.
And like your grace,
no.
You are a saucy fellow. Deserve we no more reverence?
I humbly do entreat your highness' pardon. My haste made me unmannerly. There's staying a gentleman sent from the king to see you.
Admit him entrance, Griffith. But this fellow, let me ne'er see again.
Madam.
If my sight fail not, you should be Lord Ambassador from the Emperor, my royal nephew, and your name Capucius.
Madam, the same. Your servant.
Oh, my lord, the times and titles now are altered strangely with me since first you knew me. But I pray you, what is your pleasure with me?
Noble lady, first mine own service to your grace. The next, the king's request that I would visit you, who grieves much for your weakness. And by me send you his princely commendations, and heartily entreat you to take good comfort.
Oh, my good lord, that comfort comes too late. 'Tis like a pardon after execution. How does his highness?
Madam, in good health.
So may he ever do, and ever flourish, when I shall dwell with worms, and my poor name banish the kingdom. Patience, is that letter I caused you write yet sent away?
No, madam.
Sir, I most humbly pray you to deliver this to my lord the king.
Most willingly.
In which I have commended to his goodness the model of our chaste loves, his young daughter. The dews of heaven fall thick in blessings on her. beseeching him to give her virtuous breeding. She is young and of a noble, modest nature. I hope she will deserve well. My next poor petition is that his noble grace would have some pity upon my wretched women that so long have followed both my fortunes faithfully. The last is for my men. They are the poorest, but poverty could never draw them from me, that they may have their wages duly paid them, and something over to remember me by. And good my lord, by that you love the dearest in this world, as you wish Christian peace to souls departed, stand these poor people's friend, and urge the king to do me this last rite.
By heaven I will, or let me lose the fashion of a man.
I thank you, honest lord. Remember me in all humility unto his highness. Say, his long trouble now is passing out of this world. Tell him, in death I blessed him. Also I will. My eyes grow dim. Farewell, my lord. Griffith, farewell. Nay, patience, you must not leave me yet. I must to bed. Call in more women. When I am dead, good wench, let me be used with honor. Strew me over with maiden flowers, that all the world may know I was a chaste wife to my grave. Embalm me, then lay me forth. Although unqueened, yet like a queen, and a daughter to a king, in turn. I can.
Our scenes end with the christening of Princess Elizabeth, the daughter of King Henry and his queen, Anne Bullen, in the presence of the Lord Mayor and Aldermen of the City of London and many noblemen and ladies. Immediately before the king arrives, the Garter King at Arms speaks.
Heaven, from thy endless goodness, send prosperous life, long and ever happy, to the high and mighty Princess of England, Elizabeth.
And to your royal grace and the good queen, my noble partners and myself thus pray, all comfort, joy in this most gracious lady.
Thank you, good Lord Archbishop.
What is her name?
Elizabeth.
Stand up for me.
This kiss, take my blessing.
God protect me. Into whose hand I give thy life.
Amen.
My noble gossip, ye have been too prodigal. I thank ye heartily. So shall this lady, when she has so much English.
Let me speak, sir. For heaven now bids me. And the words I utter, let none think flattery, for they'll find them true. This royal infant, though in her cradle, yet now promises a pattern to all princes living with her and all that shall succeed. Our children's children shall see this and bless heaven. Would I had known no more, but she must die. She must, the saints must have her. Yet a virgin, a most unspotted lily, shall she pass to the ground, and all the world shall mourn her.
Elizabeth!
I thank ye all. Lead the way, Lord. Ye must all see the queen, and she must thank ye. This day no man think has business at his house, or all shall stay. This little one shall make it holiday.